Michael and Mary Ellen Brennan, and Michael got up this morning with a strong word specifically for Pastor Engelhardt here. So I wanted to, hi buddy, how you doing?
You know what? Before I get a little bit, what? I mean, everybody knows here, but I want to ask you: what was the last thing you were singing? Not the song. What were you doing? You were releasing His love, releasing His love. Keep that in mind, because I think that's very significant. Are we still on? Okay. So this is for the two of you, and I just woke up this morning, was laying in bed, started thinking about you guys, and these are the thoughts that came into my heart, okay? And I've always felt this about you anyway, so I was thinking, wow, there are so many areas that you guys have laid groundwork in this region. There's just, you know, the political area you have laid groundwork in, the feeding the poor you have laid groundwork in, the schools you've laid groundwork in, marketplace you've laid groundwork in, connection to the pastors, you know, just, I just goes on and on and on. And you've laid the foundation in all these areas. And I was laying there just thinking about that and thinking that we were going to visit you this morning. And I felt really, really strongly you guys were prophesying it this morning. I feel to say to you that the Lord said to me your words, that the name of your church, Abounding Love, it is time, and you're going to hear a couple of Chosa words in here, so you're going to recognize what I'm going to say. Release and command. Okay? Release and command a whole new level of abounding love in every one of those foundations. You are to take a look at what you're doing in politics and acknowledge that your foundation days are over. You're releasing abundance, abounding love in that. You are to take a look at everything that you're doing with these pastors. These pastors are to abound. They're going to abound in the substance of His love. You're going to release in every single area where you have laid foundations. There's going to be a new spirit on you that, you know, you just said, I'm doing the stuff. Well, you're going to jump up and you're going to release the stuff. Command the stuff. You're not going to just do the stuff anymore. So it's, I just felt that so strongly to say, and I'm thinking you were prophesying that this morning without even knowing it. So it's a very significant thing that you were doing this morning, just literally using your worship to prophesy. This is a new day for you guys. This is a new time. We're moving from doing the stuff to abounding in the stuff, and we're declaring it over everything that you...
So in talking about the keys of the kingdom, Michael didn't know what I was talking about today, but that all of that was a part of the principle that I had sought the Lord in prayer before when the title or the theme was published. My team does that stuff. They look to me for whatever theme. I don't like going into a place without a firsthand knowledge, although it happens at times, and that's okay, but I really do like to get the heart of God on the people, because I love the people, but I don't love people like God loves people. God loves people, and so He's with you all the time, and I'm just a visitor, you know, into your life for a few moments, and I'd really like to know what He wants for me to enhance in your life. And the times there are changing. There's something happening very strongly. And I want to tell you that the devil has had so much of his way in the city, in New York City, for so long, and there's been such a development and such an arrogance on the part of the Satan to destroy the region from the city on. And I think we need to be aware of that fact, that there are happenings going to go on that I don't know anything about in the natural. I don't do news study or anything like that. I'm just telling you the spiritual, that there are some substantial attacks of darkness against the city this year. And there's some things. I'm not a prophet of doom or anything like that. I am, however, an annunciator, and to tell you that we need to get to work and we need to do some things. And if the devil is raising himself so strongly, then you know that God is raising himself even stronger. And the God that is in us and coming forth from us is in fact abounding. Okay, now, when we look at this region, I've got hundreds of hours in the historical study of the Hudson River Valley, from Albany all the way down to the city, and what has happened historically, because I look at land. I'm a land kind of a guy, that spiritually speaking, and in looking at the repetitive things that take place in history, they are not coincidence. They are in fact prevailing spirits. The scripture tells us in Ephesians chapter 6 that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. I often say, what part about not wrestling about with flesh and blood don't we understand? We always revert back to, in other words, wrestling with flesh and blood. We're always trying to wrestle with what we see and what we hear and the things that are natural around us. Those are the things somehow that we can put more faith into. And that's not faith at all. That's just the natural. I'm not telling you it's good, bad, or indifferent. I'm just telling you that the scripture tells us we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. That is the reason why the wickedness of the devil continually repeats his dealings with people in certain regions. And the things that go on in your region are not like the rest of the world. I travel the world, and I do a lot of intense work in different regions, and I'm telling you, y'all think differently, y'all, and that's not bad. I'm just different, you know. It's just different here, and when you begin to recognize that the things that I've spent an awful lot of time here, I've invested a lot of my time, energy. I'm away from my family right now for 3 weeks for you. Okay, it's not for me. I don't need to be here. This is not a job to me. It's a mandate from the Lord. And I'm gonna spend 3 weeks here because y'all went through one of the worst winters of your lives, and I could feel from afar, and talking to all my friends here, I know it took its toll on you. But I also know that when you come out of a darkness like that, you can come out pretty mean. And in a good way, you know. In other words, ready to tear the devil's head off after what you've been in. And I just kind of wanted to be here to put some juice to it, so that you take on the things of darkness, and we'll make some severe headway in the things of God. Okay, and so let me just say too, there's been things said here already this morning. I mean I could go on for days and days on just already what just supporting what's been said. When I was first born again, when I first gave my heart to the Lord, I was crazy. My mother spent a lot of her life in a mental institution, okay? And I was without my mom in those years, and she was sick. Her body was always sick. Her mind was always sick. And so I started right out when I was first saved. I hated sickness, and I dedicated my life to the ministry of divine healing and miracles because of that. And I just did that, okay? Well, when I was first saved, I also knew that I would never make it, and I cried out to God for over a week that, and I've told this story here before, that I cried out to God for over a week, God, if you don't fix my mind, I'll never make it. My mind wasn't right. I inherited a lot from my mother, and it just, things were not right up here, you know? And finally, one afternoon, I remember for some reason, my wife and children, it was only two of them at the time, left the house. I was home alone, and it happened to be a beautiful sunny day in Seattle. That's an odd thing. And there was that afternoon, I was crying out. I was sitting on the couch. I was crying out to God, and again about my mind, heal my mind. And the voice of God came reverberating so loud and so strong. I was surprised there was still paint on the walls. And he said to me, Wayne, you can think anything you want to think. And I said, really? Really? You're not kidding me? I can think anything I want to think. And so I got it just with those words. And I know they weren't just a knowledge or an understanding. He didn't give me an understanding there. He put words into me, delivering powerful words, and gave me the ability to think anything I want to think. Which I find that He does with all of us. We don't necessarily exercise it. And we tend to let our minds go into any place it's going to go. We lay our head down on a pillow, and we just let our brains go, let our minds go anywhere it takes us, instead of deciding from the faith that is within us where our minds are going to take us. So I laid down on the couch to take a nap. And I said, well, let's test this out. So I said, I can think anything I want to think. So here's what I want to think. Now remember, I'm only probably less than 2 weeks old in the Lord. And I said, here's what I want to think. I want to think, I see myself on a platform in Africa with a sea of black faces, beautiful black faces, and I'm preaching the gospel of the kingdom to them and seeing miracles. That's what I want to think. And that's what I thought. And I went into a light sleep there, thinking what I wanted to think instead of just whatever comes my way. Well, I began to do that, and for 14 and a half years, the same pictures, the same movie, the same images, the same platform with the same beautiful black faces, the same miracles over and over again. For 14 and a half years, that's what I thought when I laid my head down to sleep. And I say for 14 and a half years, because in 14 and a half years, I led the first missionary group into Mozambique after the communist rebel forces had been defeated. And it was pretty scary because they were trying to kill us. They were trying to burn everything that looked like us. They came into a compound just down maybe 600 yards from where we were staying on the other side of a wall and killed six people one night thinking it was us. They were, because we were Americans, you know, and they wanted to destroy us. And so we were in the capital city of Maputo then, and I was doing meetings in a big out on the airport at that time. There were no churches because the communists had done away with them all. So I was doing meetings in a big airplane hangar with thousands of people. I mean, thousands of people. It was countless. It was there was just a sea of black faces. And one night, I was in that meeting, and it wasn't dark out yet. And I was preaching the kingdom of God, and the miracles of God were instantaneous. It was I just say the word, and the miracles were wonderful. And if you don't understand what I'm saying there, ask John. He's been there and he's seen it. So it was just happening and all that sort of thing. And then after the meeting, they took me out someplace. I said, I need to get alone. So I went to a hilltop where I could oversee. I was overseeing the city of Maputa, and the sun was setting behind me and shining down upon the city. And I cried out to God. I cried out. I said, Oh Maputa, how long I have desired to gather you like a mother hen does her chicks. Now, that's what Jesus said about Jerusalem. I wasn't thinking that. I didn't even know I was quoting a scripture in the sense of I wasn't intending on that. I know the scripture. I knew it well at the time, but that's not what I was doing. It was coming out of here, way down here, you know. And then all of a sudden, the Lord gave me vision of the meeting I had just done. And he said, and it was like he said, not in words, but it was like, where have you seen that before? And I realized for 14 and a half years, I saw exactly the same platform, exactly the same faces, and exactly the same miracles. Precisely. And all the time I thought it was just my imagination. For 14 and a half years, I thought it was my imagination. Well, it wasn't my imagination. It was the Spirit of God in me being released to see and even formulate the future. Okay? Wasn't positive thinking, wasn't New Age hoopty law. It was the Spirit of God healing my mind. And when he healed my mind, he sent me into a place where I was formulating the kingdom of God upon the earth. Because I got the mind of Christ. And so do you. So do you. Now, Isaiah 22:22 says this, "Then I will set the key of the house of David on his shoulder. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open." Matthew 16 says this, "I also say to you that you are Peter. Upon this rock I will build my ecclesia, and the gates of hell," or Hades, "will not overpower it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." There's a binding and there's a loosing because there's keys, right? Then along that line, the next binding and loosing we see is two chapters later in Matthew chapter 18, and Jesus says this, "Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven." So he's repeating that phrase when he puts the keys to it, keys with it. "And whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. And again I say to you that if two or you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. And for where two or three have gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst." Now, Isaiah says, and Jesus says, there are keys, plural. In both cases, in the Hebrew and the Greek, they're plural, the words are plural. There are keys, not a key, but there are keys. And we begin to see some keys of the kingdom that have responsibility with them. That is, keys have responsibility. If you're given keys to this building, you got some responsibility, okay? And the same thing is true here. And taking upon that responsibility, not as a heavy burden or a demonic burden, but a godly burden that says you have a responsibility to carry those keys and operate with them. And there's binding and there's loosing, and there's unity, because when two of you agree on earth as touching anything they ask, it'll be given of my Father which is in heaven, means that there's a key there to unity. There's an ability to do things together in unity. And when there is unity, you've got a key. You've got an authoritative key of the kingdom of God. So it behooves us to seek unity. All right, now, Luke 11, Jesus confronts the lawgivers. My version calls them lawyers, but they're actually teachers of the, biblically, they're teachers of the Torah, okay? But my version calls it lawyers. Woe to you, lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. Aha, we just found ourselves another key. Now, this word key here is not keys, because it's speaking in context of one key. It is the key of knowledge. So you have taken away the key of knowledge. You yourselves did not enter, and you hindered those who were entering. So there must be a key of knowledge that the lawyers took and hid it from the people and wouldn't allow the people to know about it. And we've seen that over and over, repeated over and over throughout history. But the fact that when we've got bad leaders showing us religious garbage and won't let us enter in to the power of the kingdom and the authority of unlocking things in the kingdom of God with the key of knowledge. Okay? Now, Revelation, we get to Revelation, and it is said, do not be afraid, I am the first and the last. Who is this talking? Jesus, right? Okay, I am the first and the last and the living one, and I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. So now we've got keys here of death and Hades. Death and hell. And Jesus is holding them. And then it is repeated, the fulfillment unto the angel of the church of Philippi. This is Revelation 3. Unto the angel of the church of Philippi write, he who is holy, who is true, who has the key of David. It's interesting that it's the key of David again. The key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. And now, it refers in both, I began with the key of David, and I'm ending the scriptures of the key of David to tell you something about the key of David, okay? In order to see the key of David, you have to look at David. You have to look at what he was. He, first of all, was a pattern and a type of the kingdom of God. His kingdom was like no other kingdom that's ever been upon the face of the earth. There has never been a kingdom like David's kingdom. And furthermore, it is an eternal kingdom. And it's promised by God that God promised David that his kingdom would be everlasting. And yet, where is it? Well, it's in the heart of those who passionately worship God with things like the Psalms, the praise, the great Hallel. I've just done a recording for my partners on the Egyptian Hallel and the great Hallel of David and the deliverance that is there, and those things are powerful because they have the spirit of not only the author of them, who is the Holy Spirit, but the writer of them, who is David. And David's kingdom has not gone away, because his kingdom was a love, such a deep abiding love for God, that he caused all that was around him to submit to the Lord. Wow. To submit to the will of God. And so when we look at David loved God. David loved God's presence. And that's a capital P, by the way, in the Old Testament. David wanted to build Yahweh a house in the midst of his people. he looked out on the, it is stated in the scriptures that he looked out and he saw the tent of the Lord, and they'd built him this fine palace line in the cedars of Lebanon, paneled in the cedars of Lebanon, the beautiful grains of the cedars. And there he is on the cool of a day, and he's looking out, and there he sees the house of the one he loves with all his heart. And he says, why am I in a cedar paneled palace and you're out there in a tent? I know what I'm going to do. Listen to his heart. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to build you a house. And oh, what a house it will be. And Nathan the prophet just happened along at that moment. And he said to King David, oh, King David, it would not be in your heart to do so unless the Lord had placed it there. Now later, Nathan comes along and says, but you can't do it. Your son Solomon will do it. But the interesting thing is and it wasn't until the Greco-Roman gospel got preached that we ever called that house the house of Solomon or the temple of Solomon. It's never called that by the Hebrews. Hebrew, the Jews call it the house of David. It is the tabernacle of David, even referred to in Acts chapter 14 in the restoration of the tabernacle of David. It's David's house that his son Solomon, Shlomo, peace, shalom, all come from that word. The shalom, the peace of a kingdom, an overwhelming kingdom. And David had keys, and there's one that he gave the keys to. And his name is Jesus, who was of his line, who was of his bloodline. So David knew the presence of the Lord. He wanted to build Yahweh a house in the midst of his people. He knew the presence of the Lord. David knew of faith that came with deliverance. And all you have to do is read his Psalms and you see that David understood deliverance. Psalm 34, somewhere I read a long time ago that it's a Psalm that is famously passionately quoted, read worshipfully at the Passover table of God-loving Jews. In that Psalm, He says things like, many of the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord, he delivers them out of them all. And he speaks of the deliverance that was there because David, that psalm is about the time when he was under the, he was in the hands of Achish, Abimelech, and he feigned madness, you know, and Abimelech just threw him out. So he was delivered out from the bondages, and he wrote that psalm, telling about that. It was a psalm of deliverance. David knew deliverance, and listen, if your children were bound, if your children were bound, and somebody came along and set them free. Let's say, you know, there's a lot of slavery upon this earth right now. There's a lot of human trafficking that goes on. Suppose somebody came in and stole all your children and took them into slavery and in somewhere upon this earth, but somebody else came along, found your children, and delivered them out of the bondage of that slavery and brought them back to your house, that'd be pretty cool. I mean, I can only imagine what you'd be thinking and what the explosions of joy that would go off on the inside of you. And that's the kind of thing that David knew and understood. So when he worshiped, when he praised, when he spoke forth the words, they were words of deliverance. And that deliverance was to set the children of God free. And what do you think it was like when God saw his children set free? When somebody took the gumption. They rose up and began to declare the salvation of the Lord, and suddenly his children are free. Well, the same joy going off in him, just like the joy that would be going off in you if somebody set your children free. I remember when my son Joshua was out in drugs, and it was a terrible, a very terrible time, one of the worst times of my life. And I was a pastor in a thriving church in Seattle, and every day I would, it's terrible when a seer sees things like I saw. I would see my son Joshua in a coffin multiple times during the day sometimes, and it was hard, you know, it was really, really hard. And so I watched those things take place. But when my son was delivered, it was a joy. It was such a phenomenal joy that was on the inside of me. And I thank God for people that were praying for him and enunciating, even at times when I couldn't, they did. And you know, we find ourselves in a family of God that are like that. I found out after the fact, people that oftentimes were awakened in the middle of the night, stayed up all night on their hallway floors, writhing in pain over my son. And so let me bring it down to where we are right now, okay? You've got keys. You've got keys. You use keys even when you don't know their keys, or you don't. Maybe you know their keys in general, but you don't necessarily acknowledge we're going to use a key here this morning. You have keys that nonetheless, they're given to you. They're keys of the kingdom because the king delivers them to you. Now, I first started talking about spirits, principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world. The study that I've done in this region, you're sitting in the midst of a place. If you were to, I try to get all my friends up here to read the works of Washington Irving. Most people only know Washington Irving for the Headless Horseman and Rip Van Winkle. Okay, but I'm going to tell you something. He also wrote a book called The History of the State of New York, okay? And it's a very long, it's tedious to get through because he was a researcher, but he was a spiritual researcher. When he wrote The Headless Horseman, it was not a child's book. It was not what Disney made it, okay? It actually was a way just of like telling a story. Tolkien did, like Narnia, C.S. Lewis. They couldn't express to a dead church the spirituals that they understood, so they put it in fantasy. And Washington Irving did the same thing. And here, let me, for instance, suppose you're a kid and you pick up The Headless Horseman, and you know, The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, and you read this. This is in the prologue. This as the book starts. This is a quote, okay? The dominant spirit that haunts this enchanted region, that's the region we're in, and seems to be commander-in-chief of all the powers of the air, is an apparition of the figure of on horseback without a head. Where have you heard language like that before? Okay, let me. What child are you going to give this book to that's going to even understand that? But yet, you know what? Most of you in this room understood what I just now said. You've been dealing with spirituals long enough to understand what I just said. He said, the dominant spirit, powers and principalities, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places, that haunts this enchanted region seems to be commander-in-chief of the powers of the air. Ephesians chapter 2, the prince of the power of the air. And it begins to tell you in a story about the things that are happening here spiritually and where it came from. If you read his works, you'll find that he was invested in the land. His mother was Dutch, his father was English, and he knew a lot about the Dutch settlements and the Dutch people and their superstition, he says. Their superior superstition that they brought and placed in this land. Now, you look at that, and those are repetitive things that have taken place. We need to know what's above us, and we need to understand how to develop the strategies of the kingdom to unlock the things that need to be unlocked and lock down the things that need to be locked down. Amen? And so, along with what Michael said to you, I want to tell you where we are right now, okay? You don't remove the influence of principalities by going to the principalities. You just don't do that. You'll end up dead if you do that. And I got friends, when we were young, we used to do that, and I lost a couple of friends to those things because of it. Okay, but let me tell you how it does work. It's really easily seen in Luke chapter 10 when Jesus sends the 70 out, and they're out preaching the kingdom of God. When they return, it says they returned with joy. Now, how do you suppose they knew that they returned with joy? They probably were laughing and stuff, you know? Kind of like we do around here. We like joy around here. This is a church that likes joy, right? And it's okay. We can do that in church. Because joy's important. Is that right? It's one of the fruits. It is a fruit of the Spirit. Okay, so now, so they return with joy, and here's what they're reporting to the master. They're saying, Master, even demons are subject to us in your name. And Jesus says, I was watching Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Now, when I was in Bible school, they taught me that that meant way, way back before time was. He was the worship leader, and that was talking about when he sinned, and Jesus announcing that he was there too and fell from heaven like lightning. That's not what Jesus said. It doesn't even work contextually. You have to pull that thing way out of the context of what is going on in that scripture to come up with something like that. However true it might be, that's not what he was talking about. Okay, he was talking about you. If you read the first verse of the 10th chapter of Luke, it says he sent them out to every town, village, and city where he himself was going to come. Go. And so before he got there, he sent them. All right, so the next thing is they come back with joy, saying, Master, even demons are subject to us in your name. And he says, I was watching Satan fall from heaven like lightning. There's a bunch of joy going on here, and Jesus is pretty happy that he's sending the 70 out. They're doing the works at a ground level, and at the ground level, Satan is toppling, his kingdom coming out of its authoritative position over those villages and towns where they went. All right, the very arenas that Michael was talking about and how you have entered into them, I say those are ground level things, very spiritual things, and very powerful things that allow for, once those things are set, it's time to abound in the Spirit. So my visit here is a line in the sand. It's a crossing over. It's a time to look at what can be done in the heavenlies to set the captives free. Now, if you read my book, Table of the Lord, if you don't have it, you should get it. It's a booklet. I took a mass of information, my my team and I, we boiled it down so that it would be just a booklet that you could leave in the fly of your Bible. You could leave it near next to the toilet or in your bedroom or wherever, and it could stay there because you need to get it in you. It is a doctrine of warfare. It's not a doctrine of religion. It's a doctrine of warfare. And here's what it means to you. When the blood is enunciated on the doorposts and the lintel of your house, you are in a cocoon from the principalities and powers that are ruling over the land. You're placed in a spiritual cocoon. And the things of darkness and evil can't get in the house. The death angel cannot come in because there's a testimony on the doorposts and lintel. And you can say, well, I did that once. Why was the devil allowed to come in? Well, when it was fulfilled, it was given to you to do all the time. As often as you do so, Jesus used the word often. How often do you think often is? My estimation, I mean, if I had my druthers, if you could take me and stick me in a cabin in the woods someplace or in a hotel room someplace, just lock the door, throw away the key, just leave me a few cases of bread and grape juice in there, and I'd be happy the rest of my life. Staying at the table of the Lord. When you come into that table, you stay at that table. Remember who didn't? Judas Iscariot, he left the table. You know what happened to him? After all he'd done and after all he'd seen, and yet he left the table. We ought not to leave the table of the Lord. Why is it? Because you're doing the same thing that David did. You're proclaiming, you're declaring the word of God, the kingdom of God. And in so doing, this is my body which is for you. This blood is the new covenant of my blood which is for you. And this is what's on the doorpost and the lintel of my heart. This is what is on the doorpost and lintel of my home where my family lives. This is what's on the doorpost and lintel of my church. This is what is on the doorpost and lintel of my business. This is on the doorpost and lintel of my working place. Fact is, it's on the doorpost and lintel of my car. And the death angel cannot come in here. I'm in a cocoon of the Lord, and therefore I am not influenced by powers and principalities. I don't have to think their way. I don't have to act out in their way. I don't have to do what, I don't have to repeat history again in the midst. We're given keys to the kingdom. I just gave you one. And we need to understand that cocoon that we're in, that enveloped, encapsulated place of God's presence. We're encapsulated in the house of the Lord. We're encapsulated. And that house of the Lord isn't just a church. The house of the Lord is you. No, you're not. Your body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. Is that right? It's where he's chosen to abide. Your choice doesn't matter. What matters is his choice. He's the one that has chosen to abide in you and with you. And so be encapsulated with the kind of faith that David had, because that's a key. And I honestly believe that we're in a place now where there's going to be wickedness released, but we're also in a place where the kingdom of heaven is being released like never before in this region. The person I first turned me on to the superstitions that are in this land, I was hearing them but not really understanding that they're here, was reading Washington Irving. He over and over all spoke of the superstition that is here. And then after that, as I saw it and he repeated it numerous times in his writings, I started thinking seriously about it and about the Hudson River Valley and New York State as a whole, and I thought, you know, there is no place in the United States that I go to that lives in such superstition, even within the church. And I hear things out of people's mouths here that I would never hear in the Treasure Valley of Idaho where I am. And we got our problems too, but that ain't one of them. That's just not what we are, what we have. And you know why that superstition is here? Because it's that prominent spirit. It's a part of that dominant spirit that haunts this enchanted region and seems to be commander in chief of the powers of the air. And the superstition nullifies your faith, because now it's wishing, it's magic, it's superstition. That word, if you define it, you'll find that it has to do with a superior spiritual being, a superior spirit. And it's being voiced all over the place, all throughout the secular realm, and it comes into the church too. There's a tremendous amount of superstition, where our words are magic, where if we don't do this, where this terrible thing is going to happen, and so on. And we need to get out of that. How do I get out of it? Come into the cocoon. Come into the envelope of God. Come into the encapsulation of the presence of God. The encapsulation of the presence of God will protect you from even hearing the suggestions of those principalities. So come in. Come into the house of the Lord. And you know what I'm saying there. I'm not talking about this church or any church or anything like that, although this is a good spot. I'm saying there's a lot more than that. Come into the presence of the Lord, because the house of the Lord is where He is. And you can walk in His presence and not leave His presence. I've come to be in His presence so much of the time that I can't take an antihistamine. My body, it doesn't matter what kind of condition my body's in, I cannot take an antihistamine, because I found out many years ago, it scared me, because when I put an antihistamine to work in this temple, it shuts the voice of God off. Okay, now that's not what an antihistamine will do to you. That's Wayne's body. My body's different than your body, if you hadn't noticed. Okay, but there are movies I can't watch. I know I'm all right with movies, but there are movies I've never seen, Schindler's List. And you don't want to know why? Because if I see it, it will shut the voice of God off to me. Okay, you got things you do that shut the voice of God off, and you better be careful, because they're different things. And I can't judge you for what you can and cannot do, and you can't judge me for what I can and not cannot do. You probably all have seen Schindler's List, and Schindler's List was a good historic film and all that stuff, you know. But I can't do it, because the Lord says I can't do that. Ask Him why. Well, that's a long story why, and it took a long time for me to get the answer, but folks, I'm just saying, you need to stay in the presence of the Lord and don't come out of it. And if there's things that take you out of it, repent and get back on track, and don't do that anymore, because it's too dangerous to be not encapsulated by the presence of God. And these days are dangerous days, and we need it all the more. What I'm saying to you is quite possibly more important to you personally than you know right now. You didn't come here expecting to hear what I just now said, but you've nonetheless heard it. And I believe that the Lord wants you to know about it. I believe that He has been with you, He loves you, and I'm just one of His servants that comes along with the great hope that I didn't leave my wife and family back in Boise, Idaho for 3 weeks for nothing, but instead a word unto you whom He loves, a word to you whom He loves, so that your life will be enhanced by his being and his presence, and you'll be victorious, and you'll be taking up the responsibilities of those keys of the kingdom. Amen? All right, would you stand to your feet? I want to pray for you. Father, I come to you through the blood of Jesus Christ, knowing that the new and living way into your presence has been set. That highway of holiness to you and to your being is set by your behavior, not my behavior. I don't believe in my behavior, Lord. I believe in your behavior. My faith is in your behavior at all times, no matter whether my behavior would be judged as good or bad or indifferent. It's your behavior. The behavior of Jesus Christ. So therefore, I'm delivered from my behavior into yours. And I ask you, Father, to come into the hearts and lives and homes of every person listening, either here in this room or listening by recording later. I ask you, Father, to come into their life like never before. And let them know of your presence like never before. Change their hearts, change their minds by your presence, by your Spirit. And let everyone who reaches out their hand to you, let their hand be filled with the keys of the kingdom of God, including the key of David, including the key of knowledge, including the keys of death and Hades, including the key of unity, including the keys, all the keys of love of your kingdom. Father, I ask you for a desire inside every person listening to me right now. Put a Holy Ghost desire in them to come into your presence, to come into that cocoon, into that encapsulation of your presence, so that the principalities and powers will not have rulership or authority of any kind over them, because their authority is the blood of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Father, for what you're going to do in the future, the delivering power that's coming out of this room in abounding love. Through Jesus' name, amen? Amen.
Amen, amen. We're going to worship. If you just need to soak in his presence, just feel that. If you need to go, be released. Please take fellowship out in the outside the sanctuary, outside or out in the cafe, so people who can soak. But maybe there's some activation that needs to happen. Based on that, the first step in knowledge is to admit that we don't know what we don't know. And so we just soak. I'm just half soaking right now, so that's why I'm kind of talking funny, because the Spirit of God is here. So just be released, be blessed, have a great day if you need to go. But if you want to stay and just soak in his presence, you can sit, you can stand, you can come to the altar, you can kneel, just whatever you feel comfortable with. Amen. So Father, we bless each one here. In your precious name, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, let us go forth as the 70 and return with the testimony that we might see Satan fall like lightning over this territory, that we would do a grassroots motion to see your kingdom advance, God, because that's what we're about. We thank you, God, in thy name. Amen. We will practice those keys Thursday night, just saying. Amen.
just become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your presence. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. overcome by your presence, Lord.